Hello and welcome to COVID Conversations here on WNCU 90.7 FM, streaming on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm your host, Kimberly Pierce Cartwright. I'm the News and Public Affairs Director here at WNCU. And we're using the Zoom platform to talk about how COVID-19 is affecting our world. And today, we're going to talk about a different kind of rivalry between two HBCUs, North Carolina Central University and A&T State University. The longtime rivalry will now include a battle against the COVID-19 pandemic. And here to talk to me about that today is Dr. Mari Rose Alexander, the Assistant Vice Chancellor for Health and Wellness at North Carolina Central University. Hello and welcome, and thank you so much for being with me today.
Well, thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Dr. Ross Alexander, now everybody loves a good competition. How did the Eagle Aggie Crush COVID competition come to be?
So, you know, we do a lot with A&T actually. We collaborate with them when they were setting up their vaccine clinic. They helped us set up our vaccine clinic. So we're always looking for ways to encourage one another. And we saw that the vaccination rates just were not going the direction we wanted them to go. So after some conversations, this COVID crush came up, or crush COVID, I guess I should say,
yeah,
came up, and we decided to just have a friendly rivalry like we do in lots of other things.
I love the name, by the way, Crush COVID. That sounds like it's going to be a very rousing competition between these two schools who have been sister schools in the UNC system and have been rivals for such a long time. I want you to talk to me about how long the competition is going to go on and who is going to be involved as participants in the competition.
So the competition started on July 1st. It actually ends on September 17th. And we're asking all faculty, students, and staff to upload their vaccine cards to our systems and to prove that our campuses are going to be safe because we're all fully vaccinated.
That's exciting. So what about if you know, everybody might not have saved that little card. When I looked at mine, I said, oh, is it possibly a throwaway? So is that very important, an important element of this?
Absolutely. So that vaccination card is kind of your ticket to proving that you are fully vaccinated. So I highly encourage folks to take a picture of their card, save it on their phone. I mean, that's like almost like paper gold. So make sure you have your vaccination card. Now, if you got vaccinated at a qualified center, you can find your vaccine information on the CVMS website. So you can go on there. You should have registered. You can upload a copy of the actual record from that site as well.
So talk to me a little bit more about CVMS. What is that exactly if people don't understand?
Oh, that was a trick question. It's COVID Vaccination Management System. So when you went to get vaccinated, you probably got an email from CVMS saying you are vaccinated or you have an appointment to be vaccinated. And you can also log back in there to get access to your record as well.
So what is the university community saying about the challenge? There may be some people out there who's still saying, you know what, I'm afraid of that needle, or I've got my apprehension about it. So what are you hearing? What's the buzz around campus?
You know, it's kind of mixed, to be quite honest with you. We have some folks who are gung-ho, they have their vaccination, they wear their sticker, they're so excited to be able to come back to campus, and some that are apprehensive. So we've done all kinds of marketing campaigns and education campaigns to help folks understand what the vaccine is, what it's not. Right now, our participation is relatively high in folks uploading their records. I think we're a little bit ahead of A&T, so I have to put that out there. But yeah, so it's mixed, but most folks do want to come back to campus, and they want to come back to campus as safely as possible.
Well, when you said that, it took everything that I could hold in myself without going, go NCCU. If I had pom-poms, I guess it would be a better visual image, but I'm really excited about NCCU and possible bragging rights. So let's talk about that. The winning school gets what?
Well, get a trophy and bragging rights that will never let the other person live down. Forever and Ever. And that's going to be presented at the Eagle Aggie football game in Greensboro on the 25th of September.
It sounds so good when you say that it's going to be at a football game, because I'm sure that everybody will be really raring to go to get out and really enjoy some outside time and seeing two really great universities battle out on the gridiron. That'll be a really good day. And then, you know, bragging rights in the stadium. Absolutely. What's better than that?
What's that? I'm sorry.
I said, what could be better than bragging rights at a state?
Exactly. And for a whole forever. We're never going to let them live it down.
So. Okay. Well, is a loser really a loser in the competition? I'm going to put the big L up there.
Only in theory. So, you know, if we're really trying to crush COVID, everybody wins when we have safe campuses. But we definitely will remind them, because we're going to win. We'll definitely remind them that they did not do as well as we did, but there is not a loser in this battle.
Okay, very good. I want to talk now about the rate of infection at NCCU. Is it higher or lower than the local and national averages? And I would imagine that total would be a good indicator about how we'll transition back to students being on campus.
So NCCU did extraordinarily well with our infection rates, or low infection rates. So we are 1.5%. So that, you know, that is nationally, internationally, a phenomenal number. We were actually cited in Washington Post for our numbers. So we've done extraordinarily well. We're one of the lowest transmission rates in the system, the whole system of North Carolina school system. So we've done extraordinarily well here. I anticipate we'll continue to do that. Our students are very compliant. They care, and they take care of one another.
So could you talk a little bit more about how maybe the numbers have been kept down? What's been the attitude? Is it that so many students have not been on campus, or while they're on campus? What are they doing? What's the magic answer here?
You know, I think we had a really strong education campaign. We saw this pandemic starting on my side of the world, January, February of 2020, I think that is, yes. And so by the time we got to March, when we did do our whole shutdown, we had already had a game plan. We were already educating our students and helping them understand what this pandemic was going to look like. So we had a lot of forecasting that happened, but we have really great students. Our students listen, they're compliant young people. And they, like I said, they care about their communities. They didn't want to take this back to their homes and to their grandparents and their parents. And so they followed our directions, and they did that well. And we had, you know, again, we have a team of folks here that made sure that they were safe. If we did have a COVID case, we were able to manage those pretty well and keep that spread from happening on our campus and even off of our campus with our students that lived at a distance.
What about North Carolina as a whole? Do you have any information about how our state is doing as far as people getting the vaccine?
So we're not doing well. So we are the 12th lowest in the nation in getting vaccinations. So we really need to push to make sure that our family, our friends, our colleagues are actually adhering to this pandemic and to the requirements. The pandemic is not over. In fact, I think there's gonna be a second run here shortly. And so vaccines are our best and greatest way of protecting ourselves and our communities.
So North Carolina Central University has been a distribution site for vaccines, not only for the university, but the community at large. And I got my vaccine at North Carolina Central University. So, how has vaccinating not only faculty, staff, and people who work here at North Carolina Central, but the community at large? I thought that was really exciting to be able to offer that service.
Yes, so we have vaccinated over 4,300 folks in our community, our faculty, our staff, like you said, community members as well. You know, I think it's a duty. HBCUs have a duty to their community to make sure their community is safe. So we, you know, as soon as we were eligible to do that, we jumped on it and started vaccine clinics in early March. And we run them almost weekly currently. So there's a vaccine clinic happening today. So if somebody wants to come get vaccinated, they can. And we'll have them every Tuesday up until August the 10th. And then that schedule will change a little bit. But yes, we'll still have vaccines available for the community.
That is so great. How many vaccines have the schools between A&T and North Carolina Central given to people? What's that number looking like right now?
So we're looking at about 14,600 vaccines between the two campuses. So, you know, we've done our part, I think, but there's still a lot of work to do.
Are students going to be required to have a vaccine before they come back to school? And have you been getting questions from students anticipating their return?
So no, students will not be required to have the vaccine. They're strongly encouraged to do so, but they do not have to have the vaccine. Now, what we will do is we'll have high frequency surveillance testing. So that means that if you're not vaccinated student, you will be subjected to testing at a higher frequency than what you probably want. So every week we'll be testing our students that are on our campus. And so hopefully that'll encourage them to get vaccinated, but we'll also know if we have the virus on our campus.
Could we talk about maybe some of the other measures that the university is taking to make sure that there is a smooth transition back?
So, you know, education is the key. So we're doing town halls. We have pop-up conversations with our students. Our Office of Health Promotions does a lot of videos and social media marketing around what we're doing to be safe. Of course, we have environmental safety, who's integral into making sure that we're all safe here with social distancing and making sure that we have a sanitary environment. And again, that high frequency testing allows us to understand and plot out if and when we have the virus on our campus.
Okay. So if anyone wants additional information about this challenge, how can they be in touch?
So the best way is to go onto the website at nccu.edu/crushcovid, and information about our competition is there.
Very good. Nice to meet you.
Very nice meeting you as well.
Yes, Dr. Mari Ross Alexander, Assistant Vice Chancellor for Health and Wellness at North Carolina Central University, has been my guest today. I appreciate your time very much. And thank you, audience, for watching via YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram, as well as listening on WNCU 90.7 FM. We want you to be sure to like us. We want you to follow us. Subscribe to our pages to see more of our archive shows. I'm Kimberly Pierce Cartwright, your host, and we appreciate your time. Thank you so much for listening.